Thinking Aloud. Conversations on the leading edge of knowledge and discovery with psychologist Jeffrey Mishlove.
Hello and welcome. I'm Jeffrey Mishlove. Today we are going to look at the hard problem of consciousness. With me is Stuart Hameroff, who is a professor of anesthesiology and psychology at the University of Arizona, director of the Center for Consciousness Studies at the University of Arizona. He is the author of a book called Ultimate Computing, Biomolecular Consciousness and Nanotechnology. That book was published 30 years ago, and subsequently, he has been developing a theory of consciousness known as ORC-OR, and has also been a pioneer in the movement to establish consciousness as a serious topic of scientific inquiry. Welcome, Stuart.
Thank you, Jeffrey. It's good to see you again.
It's a pleasure to be with you. We might say, for starters, that 2 years ago I had the great privilege of conducting a six-part series of interviews with you that constituted, I think, a fairly good overview of the ORC-OR theory. So now, 2 years later, is an opportunity for us to go into more detail on some of the key points of that theory, and in particular, what is known as the hard problem, because as I've been thinking about it, your theory is probably the first, maybe the only scientific theory of which I'm aware to seriously address the hard problem. To me, that's what makes it unique.
Well, thank you. I should add that this came out of my collaboration with Roger Penrose, and it was Roger's 1989 book, The Emperor's New Mind, which introduced the idea of objective reduction, a type of collapse of the wave function as a mechanism for consciousness and a potential solution to the hard problem.
Now, let me stop you for a second, if I may, because you used the term mechanism, and I'm inclined to think, from what little I know of Roger Penrose's work, that mechanism might not be the right word here, because ultimately, he doesn't think consciousness is mechanistic, does he?
Well, I say that because when I've discussed this with philosophers like David Chalmers, who coined the hard problem, and I say things like objective reduction, collapse of the wave function causes consciousness, he says, well, then that doesn't mean it's this. You know, a lot of things cause consciousness. Breathing causes consciousness. Blood flowing causes consciousness. Are you saying it's equivalent to consciousness? But there's a trap, because if you say, well, collapse is consciousness, then you have an identity theory. And then they say, well, that's an identity theory, and everybody knows that that doesn't work. And the reason they know it doesn't work, they say, is because identity theories by materialists don't work. So I would say that it's equivalent to consciousness, that self-collapse is consciousness. Yeah. It gives experience and also chooses particular states of reality and action in our brains.
Because as I recall in our previous interview, you suggested proudly that it is an identity theory. You're not backing off of that.
No, Dave tried to finagle me, but I stuck to my guns.
So You collaborated with Roger Penrose in developing the ORC-OR theory, and he really was pinpointing the hard problem. But your unique contribution is to show how you could combine a quantum mechanical approach with what we know about the nervous system in the brain.
Right. When I read Roger's book in about 1991, I had been studying microtubules inside neurons for about 20 years. Yeah. Most people view the brain as a collection of 100 billion neurons acting like bits and synapses as switches. Yeah. The brain is a neuronal computer. If you get sufficiently complex computation, then they say consciousness emerges, voila, at a critical level of complexity. But nobody's explained what that is. Tononi's tried with this Phi stuff, or why that should, the rationale for why that should be conscious. Roger went through this elaborate Gödel's theorem argument, saying that consciousness requires something non-computable, that understanding, and the way I look at it is that understanding, if you know something, it's more a feeling than an equation. Yeah. You know something's right, you feel it. The equation might point to it, but you have to know it. So that's a simplistic way to do it, but he argued more rigorously through Gödel's theorem. But These objective reductions, it's a self-collapse of the wave function, and he started by saying that superposition of particles being in multiple states at once, which is the measurement problem in quantum mechanics, were actually due to curvatures in space-time geometry. So mm-hmm. he made this incredible leap from quantum mechanics to general relativity, which in and of itself is a tremendous feat.
Yeah.
And this would be, these objective reductions would be happening due to little ripples in space-time everywhere in the environment. And there would be little bits of experience, but random, disconnected, and lacking meaning.
Mm-hmm.
And this seems kind of bizarre that there might be this subjectivity in some sense everywhere around us. But when you consider that mainstream neuroscientists like Christoph Koch and Giulio Tononi resort to panpsychism to explain consciousness because they can't account for the heart problem. And in panpsychism, it's a little ill-defined that experience or consciousness is painted on atoms, molecules, quarks, you know, what level they don't say. And here it's the idea that those particles are actually being created all the time by quantum events and collapse of the wave function. But then the question is, how do you combine these willy-nilly, here, there, and everywhere type moments of experience into the type of full, rich consciousness we have?
Yeah.
In panpsychism, that's called a combination problem. We took it from the standpoint that in the brain, the microtubules are organizing or orchestrating these moments into full, rich consciousness. And mm-hmm. a good analogy, I think, would be if you go to the symphony and before they start playing, the orchestra's warming up and each musician is playing a note or tone on his or her instrument,
right.
It's noise. It's a cacophony.
Yeah.
It's a cacophony, exactly. And then they begin to play and it's music.
Mm-hmm.
And the difference between the OR moments occurring everywhere in the environment and what happens in our brain is the difference between the cacophony and the symphony.
The OR moments, that's objective reduction.
Objective reduction.
Or the collapse of the wave function.
Due to an objective threshold, which, so if you're going back to the idea of the curvature being a particle over here and a superposition be a curvature here and a curvature here, so you have actually a separation in space-time geometry. Now, you know about the multiple worlds hypothesis,
yes.
where every possibility evolves its own universe.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be the start of the multiple worlds idea. But Roger said these separations are unstable,
mm-hmm.
and after time t will reduce to one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
And the choice of which they choose is at, or which is chosen, they is pejorative there, which is chosen is influenced by what he called non-computable Platonic values implicit
mm-hmm.
in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
So the way I look at that is that these selections and processes are resonating with the structure of reality.
Yeah.
And if we're mindful, we might tend to make proper ethical aesthetic decisions, choices, and perceptions as opposed to the opposite.
Yeah. Now, I know at this point, many of our viewers who are familiar with these issues and have been for years will be following us, and other viewers
right.
will be totally lost because you've introduced so many technical terms.
Right.
But, of course, many people have been following your work for decades.
Thank you to them.
Indeed, but let's just define for those viewers who are a little uncertain what we mean by the hard problem.
Right. So David Chalmers made this term famous,
mm-hmm.
actually in a paper and in a talk at the first Tucson. You were there at the Tucson
there.
Conference in 1994.
Yeah.
The first morning was philosophy, and the first two speakers were rather boring, reading without slides, and the interdisciplinary audience is falling asleep and rolling their eyes. And the third speaker was a then unknown young Australian philosopher with hair down to his waist, prancing around the stage like Mick Jagger, talking about things like memory, attention, learning were relatively easy compared to the really hard problem of why we have conscious experience at all.
At all.
At all.
Yeah.
And we could have been a race of zombies, of people behaving with complex activities and behaviors, but without any inner light, without
mm-hmm.
any inner consciousness.
Yeah.
And yet we do, or at least I know I do,
mm-hmm.
you know you do,
yeah.
but we can't verify it in other people, and that's the hard problem.
Yeah.
And I remember as the conference organizer, after his talk, I went around listening to eavesdropping on people at the coffee breaks. They were talking about the heart problem, and that really galvanized the movement.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Tom Nagel and other people, and Frank Jackson and other philosophers had characterized the heart problem different ways, but Dave really kind of gave it a modern, hip, trendy attribute. So, what are the potential solutions? Well, As I said, some people believe in panpsychism, that mm-hmm. there's qualia. Qualia are the experiential attributes, redness, blueness, envy, mm-hmm. pain, whatever, yeah. how low you want to take it. Subjective experience, phenomenal experience, are yeah. everywhere. Mm-hmm. And panpsychists would say, well, they're everywhere, and that's their solution, but then how do you combine it into what we have? Mm-hmm. Others would say, well, there is no heart problem, like materialists. Pat Churchland, Dan Dennett said it's just an illusion. Consciousness is an illusion. An illusion to whom? I don't know.
But even an illusion implies subjective experience.
Exactly. So I think that's a non-starter, uh-huh. but they're very materialistic.
Yeah.
And then there are the Mysterians, mm-hmm. people like Steven Pinker or Colin McGinn, who say, we cannot come up with a solution to the hard problem. It's ineffable. It's beyond our comprehension. It'd be like expecting a goldfish to understand general relativity or something like that. Mm-hmm. And I asked Steven Pinker this after he said that at one of our conferences, and I said, well, what about quantum mechanics as a solution to the hard problem? He said, well, I don't know anything about quantum mechanics. And I said, well, maybe if you did, it wouldn't be so ineffable. So there's yeah. that. And then there's people like, then there's the idealist, Bishop Berkeley, historically, and, yeah. and Eastern philosophers, Deepak Chopra, who say consciousness is everything, mm-hmm. and reality is an illusion.
Yeah.
So you have, on the one hand, people saying consciousness is an illusion, the other people saying reality is an illusion. And somewhere in the middle, I think Roger's approach really addresses all of these. Oh, and then there are dualists, of course. People yeah. like Dave Chalmers is a dualist, who would say, well, there's a material world, and then there's this other world that has consciousness in it, but without defining it scientifically. Mm-hmm. And I think Roger's approach and the approach we've taken kind of has the best aspects of all of those. It kind of says that, well, there's this quantum world and there's this material, classical world, kind of like dualism, and consciousness is quite literally on the edge between the quantum and the classical.
Yeah.
When the quantum collapses to the classical, that's a process, that's an event. So it says that consciousness is a process, kind of like Alfred North Whitehead's idea of moments of experience, mm-hmm. So occasions of experience.
Yeah.
And so it's also kind of like panpsychism, except that rather than a property of matter, it's an event which mm-hmm. creates the state of that matter. It's not quite Mysterian. It's not quite idealist, but it has aspects of all of those.
Now, and let's go into the issue, which I think is central to Roger's work and your work, the idea that the collapse of the wave function in quantum theory would result in consciousness. How does that even come up? Let's begin by defining what we mean by collapse of the wave.
Right.
Function.
Well, even that's controversial. So yeah. In the early days of quantum mechanics, the turn of the 20th century, Niels Bohr and many other people were discovering that quantum systems could be in superposition of multiple states or locations simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
They inferred that from various things. But when they made a measurement of that system, when they had a device look at it or they observed it themselves, they only saw one particular state of reality.
Right.
So rather than a particle being here and there, when they looked at it, it was here or there.
Mm-hmm.
And a picture is not smeared out on the wall, it's just one picture. So. Right. That became known as the measurement problem.
Mm-hmm.
And their solution was very pragmatic. They said that conscious observation causes collapse of the wave function.
Right.
So it's in multiple possibilities until you look at it.
Mm-hmm.
Schrodinger pointed out the absurdity of this with his famous thought experiment, Schrodinger's cat, where he coupled a quantum event, a quantum particle to poison in a box. The cat was, according to him, is a superposition of both dead and alive until someone opened the box.
Mm-hmm.
And then consciousness caused the collapse. And that worked pragmatically. They could do their experiments. But mm-hmm. it put consciousness kind of outside science. They didn't define it. It was pretty much dualist. And it didn't really explain underlying reality. And then the other explanations are decoherence, that the quantum states kind of erode, or the multiple worlds that each possibility
mm-hmm.
Branches off and finds its own. So Roger's idea kind of turned Niels Bohr idea of consciousness causing collapse, which became known as the Copenhagen interpretation.
Right, because Bohr was standard interpretation.
Right, mm-hmm. and Bohr was from Denmark. Roger turned it around. Instead of consciousness causing collapse, collapse causes consciousness, or collapse is consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So, and when you say it is, then you kind of, it actually comes closer to Copenhagen. But it pretty much turned it around 180 degrees.
Because the idea being that the actual experience of people is here or there. That it's
right.
So that is a moment of awareness.
Right. I only see one of you. I assume you only see one of me. But maybe in your subconscious, I'm smeared out like a wave or multiple, and likewise. But that's in your subconscious, your quantum subconscious, I would say. But then there's a collapse, and there's one of me. If you look at anything, it's in a definite state. So that's collapse. It basically says that there's the possibilities reduce or collapse to one possibility. Now, a lot of people say there is no collapse. Multiple worlds say no, every possibility continues. Bohm says that there's this pilot wave that guides and chooses the collapse. But the other problem with nobody could really define superposition, so they kind of shied away from addressing collapse till Roger connected quantum superposition to a general relativity and this curvature in space-time, and that related it to multiple worlds and other things. So I think it relates to panpsychism to some extent. It relates to Copenhagen. It relates to decoherence. It relates to multiple worlds, and kind of takes the best features of both and gives what I think is a pretty good solution.
Yeah. Now, the alternative to the hard problem that I gather is still kind of a mainstream view in the field of neurology, neurophysiology, is the idea of emergence, that when consciousness gets, or when the brain, when the nervous system gets sufficiently complex, consciousness emerges. And I know when I interviewed you last about that, you use the analogy of wetness, that when you bring enough water molecules together, you get wetness.
Right. Emergence goes back to nonlinear dynamics and chaos theory and various mathematical equations, which are nonlinear. They go along, and then all of a sudden, something completely different happens at a threshold. And Tononi, for one, has tried to bring this back. I worked for many years with a guy named Alwyn Scott. He was one of the co-founders of our center. He started the Center for Nonlinear Studies at Los Alamos. And so I got invited to a lot of those early meetings on chaos theory and nonlinear dynamics up there. And it was very interesting. And Al, who I love dearly, tried to relate emergence to consciousness to solve the hard problem. He didn't want to get into quantum. So we remained really good friends, but we disagreed strongly on this point. Yeah. And he wrote a wonderful book about it called Stairway to the Mind back in the 90s. And it's a good argument for emergence relating to consciousness. But I didn't buy it. And
Why not?
Because I thought it was just kind of a default position. I think it was like, if nothing else seems to work, it must be emergence.
Some people refer to that as promissory materialism.
Yes, exactly. Trust me, there's some threshold out there. Yeah. And Tononi's come up with this threshold, but the problem with it, it's completely arbitrary. It could work at the level of neurons, it could work at the level of microtubules, could work at the level in a thermostat. And his main claim to fame for it is that it explains why the cerebellum is in consciousness, because the neurons are wired differently. But there's other reasons to explain why the cerebellum isn't conscious, and some people think it is, actually, including the fact they don't have pyramidal cells. So I don't buy it, and basically, I think Alwyn Scott was way ahead of all others in emergence theory, and he couldn't do it either. He didn't know the level at which to apply it, so it has severe problems.
But would you agree with me that it's the case that most of the psychologists, neurophysiologists, people working in academic environments tend to sort of implicitly accept the emergence hypothesis?
Or they ignore the problem altogether.
Yeah.
So, but if you press them, it happens at some high level of complexity. But again, there's no evidence for that. And it belies the possibility of consciousness in smaller organism, and what's the threshold, what's the cutoff, and so forth. So it has a lot of problems.
Yeah. Now, earlier, you were suggesting that, before we started our interview, you were suggesting that there's a connection between the hard problem and evolution.
Right. Let me preface this by saying Dave Chalmers told me, people really dislike your quantum consciousness ideas. They're going to hate your quantum evolution ideas because people are very attached to evolution theory. But, the whole idea that lower animals and us, everybody, is evolving to promote their gene survival mm-hmm. in Dawkins' take on Darwin
yeah.
is really kind of silly, I mm-hmm. think. Why would a gene give a damn about anything?
Whether or not it survives.
It doesn't have any feelings, right.
Yeah.
Now, if you're a panpsychist, or if you follow ORCOR and OR, mm-hmm. then you would have to say that some, at least primitive experience, has been in the universe all along, mm-hmm. or at least preceding life. Mm-hmm. And so I have a chapter which I sent to you about, I'm now calling it the quantum pleasure principle, mm-hmm. because I talk about what happened in the primordial soup, which is the consensus view of where life emerged.
Yeah.
And we know from experiments by Miller and Urey in the 50s that—
Classic.
Yes.
Really classic.
Where they simulated the primordial soup. They put in the ingredients they thought were there. They put little sparks in for lightning, the right temperature. And at the end, they looked and they found organic molecules, mm-hmm. Amphipathic organic molecules. Organic molecules basically means a six-sided ring, mm-hmm. like benzene, like what goes in our gas tanks, mm-hmm. but where it's very flammable, obviously. Yeah. But benzene rings, six-sided rings with three extra electrons, you get a quantum electron cloud, mm-hmm. and they're the basis of all organic chemistry. Mm-hmm. Lipids, nucleic acids, proteins, certain amino acids, and they're essential. It's basically mm-hmm. organic chemistry. Now, these would have been present with polar tails. So oil and water don't mix. These are oily, but then they have a tail on them that has charges. Mm-hmm. And so the charges would be soluble in water, and the oil would stick together.
Yeah.
So Operin and Haldane, who came up with the primordial soup idea, Operin had this idea that the oily centers would come together and the tails would stick out, causing what he called micelles, primitive cells. And this is really the basis for proteins, where you have aromatic amino acids that go in the middle, and the tails stick out so they're soluble in blood or water, and also lipids, lipid bilayers, and also nucleic acids. So all the forms of biomolecules have this arrangement with a nonpolar oil-like organic center, which is conducive to quantum effects. Mm-hmm. The point is that when you have these aromatic rings that are arrayed in a critical arrangement and distance, that they can have cooperative quantum effects, and they will actually oscillate in terahertz, 10 to the 12th hertz, which is very, very fast compared to biological processes.
Yeah.
But if, I developed the idea that in the primordial soup, these micelles, operin micelles, would coalesce, and they would start oscillating together, forming collective quantum states, and they would reach Roger's threshold for objective reduction. They had to be fairly large or take a long time, mm-hmm. and they would have a moment of experience. Mm-hmm. And some of those would be pleasurable, okay? Some wouldn't be, they'd be random or displeasurable, what have mm-hmm. you.
So then maybe the very earliest experiences are simply pleasure and pain.
Pleasure, pain, or something in between.
Pleasure or discomfort.
Yes, or fear.
Fear.
And, a lot of people are fear-based, a lot of mm-hmm. people are pleasure-based. I think that continues today. So what I suggest in this chapter was that these moments of pleasure provided a feedback fitness function for these micelles and primitive molecular complexes to grow and literally evolve. Mm-hmm. And rather than, there were no genes then, this was, I don't know, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years before genes, mm-hmm. The feedback fitness function would be to maximize pleasure. And so, and the aromatic rings, the benzene rings, can be in a couple different configurations.
Yeah.
And so they would feedback to give the configuration that would optimize pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I suggest this is why life originated, to take advantage of this pleasure, and that organisms subsequently evolved to optimize pleasure. And I think that continues to today. I mean, any experiment in a lab with a rat or anything, they seek reward, they seek pleasure, dopamine, mm-hmm. they do this to get a pleasure. And humans do the same. Now, it could be hedonistic, it could be altruistic. It feels better to give than to receive. It could mm-hmm. be spiritual. It could be whatever, you know, makes you feel good.
So the pleasure principle, as you're defining it here, would sort of introduce the notion of purpose or teleology into science.
Yes, exactly, exactly. To optimize pleasure,
mm-hmm.
and or to avoid displeasure, fear, or pain.
Yeah.
And again, it's not necessarily completely hedonistic. It could be altruistic, and that's what I. To me, that makes a lot more sense than we do things to promote our gene survival.
So you're talking about really the earliest membranes being formed even before we had such things as mitochondria or,
right.
or cells, there,
right.
there needed to be membranes.
Membranes in my cells. Mm-hmm. So the a membrane is kind of a double layer of a micelle. A micelle could just be a globule, but all of these structures, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids have a quantum interior. Mm-hmm. And in microtubules, they're very this interior is continuous and goes in a spiral.
Mm-hmm.
And in work with my colleagues Travis Craddock and Jack Tusinski, we've been working on this, and we have a chap. We point out that this quantum, we call it the quantum underground. I'll just cut to the chase.
Okay.
Yeah, underlies all biomolecules.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look in a cell, you look in the membrane, in the interior of the membrane, you see the quantum entities, the aromatic rings aligned in the middle of a nucleic acid, in the middle of a protein. So this quantum underground is everywhere in all biomolecules. Now, in between are the polar aqueous kind of random noisy environment that everybody says would destroy quantum effects. But we think that it's happening in the quantum underground, and particularly in microtubules because it's arrayed in a particular way.
So you're suggesting that this primitive consciousness is in effect responsible for the evolution of all of organic chemistry.
Well, the evolution of life,
uh-huh.
and based on organic chemistry, it addresses the question of evolution as a motivation. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, Darwin is a pillar of science, and I don't think what I'm saying contradicts him.
Mm-hmm.
I think what it contradicts is what I would call Dawkins' take on it, which is the selfish gene.
The blind watchmaker.
Yes, mm-hmm. that it's all about survival of genes. But mm-hmm. it doesn't make any sense. How did we get from the first life to genes? I don't know, a million years, I'm not quite sure how long. Why would a gene give a damn about mm-hmm. anything if there's no feelings?
Yeah.
So the whole problem with evolution, although Darwin actually talked a lot about feelings and drives and whatnot, but it wasn't part of his whole big picture.
Yeah.
So
because his theory is not teleological.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But I think if you put feelings into it right from the start, you get a teleological mm-hmm. Result.
Stuart Hameroff, what a pleasure to be with you again. I know this has been a very meaty discussion. Thank you so much for being with me.
Thank you, Jeffrey.
And thank you for being with us.